Fashion is big bucks, one of the largest industries in the world. The last decade has seen consumer spending rise to dizzying heights, hundreds of billions annually.
And through those years, we saw this great, great, great inflation in the whole realm of fashion. It began to seem terribly important. It began to get coverage. It basically, I think, replaced rock and roll as the primary cultural artifact.
All the 80s was good news for fashion. You had right-wing governments in most of the major economies, Reagan in the States, Thatcher in the UK. They had tough fiscal policies. They reduced taxation, particularly for the very wealthy. And so people, particularly the people who had enough money to buy expensive clothes, expensive perfumes, felt rich.
And if the consumer felt rich, it was nothing to how some designers felt. The turnovers of their fashion businesses could easily swallow up the gross national products of some third world countries, and what a handful take home in a year could wipe out national debts. The strange thing is, many of these clothes designers aren't making most of their money designing clothes. Real success in the fashion industry is predicated not so much on the brilliance of your cut as the brilliance of your marketing strategy. And frequently, that strategy centers on a word, a single name.
My name is Calvin Klein.
It's not Donna Karan, it's Donna Karen.
Io mi chiamo Giorgio Armani.
My name is Vivian Westwood.
My name is Karl Lagerfeld.
My name is Christian Lacroix.
I'm Gianni Versace.
My name is Valentino.
My name is Ralph Lauren.
My name is Paloma Picasso.
My name is Karl Lagerfeld. Je m'appelle Karl Lagerfeld. Il mio nome è Karl Lagerfeld. And I can only speak four languages, so don't ask it in Japanese or Chinese because I'm not able.
And once you've made it, you can put it on anything. Underwear, cigarettes, deodorant, teddy bears, chess sets, tropical fruit.
Oscar de la Renta papayas. They're really good, you should try them. They're really wonderful.
Bath towels, ties, watches, sunglasses, cufflinks, biros. And it all goes back to one man, the man who became a label. Pierre Cardin made his name in the 60s with a bold line in space age-inspired designs, saw the future, of his own name at least, and decided to lend it, or rather sell it dearly, to a stream of products, some 800 at last count, few of which he designed or has even seen. He is the richest designer in the world, and he foresaw early on his greatest asset.
My name? My name is protecting around the world for 110 countries.
But a name is like any other product. You have to make it before you can sell it.
Mio nome è mio, privato, mi ha fatto mia madre, mio padre.
Private, maybe, but Giorgio Armani is now the name on a $1.5 billion turnover fashion empire. Emperor Armani, the man who trained to be a doctor but couldn't stand the sight of blood and didn't even want to be a designer.
Forse lo scrittore, forse il regista, forse delle cose più così, ma la moda non mi affascinava più di tanto. Il diventare un nome internazionale, diventare un nome come I famosi nomi che sono in giro, era quasi una cosa che non era al di là delle mie aspettative. Non pensavo di poter, neanche volevo, tutto sommato. Poi tutte le cose arrivano per un destino, non si sa perché.
Destiny or design? Something must explain the marketing phenomenon of the 80s. How did these typical Armani statements, understated, almost anodyne in 101 shades of beige, come to encapsulate the aspirations of a decade? Armani, like Cardin in the 60s, identified the consumer mood of his age, elitist, ambitious, discriminating. With no formal fashion training, Armani, former buyer, now master of minimalism, tailored a comprehensive clothing identity to his own marketing insights. Insight number one, the jacket. Armani softened men's jackets and hardened women's. In his hands, the jacket became the central fashion motif of the yuppie era. For women, a unisexual uniform of success without the frilly bits. Armani, the philosopher.
La giacca nasconde, la giacca può far pensare, è un po' più misteriosa la giacca. È una specie di protezione, una specie di scudo, di armatura moderna che aiuta a vivere, E in particolare la giacca, il vestito scopre troppo, il vestito è molto... Tu vedi una donna con un vestito, sai com'è fatta, sai che cos'ha nel suo corpo, lo vedi. La giacca nasconde, la giacca può far pensare, è un po' più misteriosa la giacca. E poi dà delle forme che magari la donna non ha, l'uomo non ha, quindi l'aiuta anche a migliorare.
In a designer label obsessed age, Armani will go down in history as the man who power dressed the whole new post-war baby boom generation which had entered the workplace. But however minimalist the Armani look may be, the price isn't. £1,000 for a suit, £8,000 for a beaded evening jacket. So how many people can actually afford to sport the Armani label stitched elegantly in white on black on the Giorgio Armani Via Borgo Nuovo label? And so how big can your business possibly be? Being a rich designer doesn't mean designing for a few rich clients. Hence insight number two.
La gente si è molto mescolata adesso, il ricco, il povero, alla fine le vacanze sono vacanze per tutti, si può tutti andare a Mustique a fare vacanze, una volta era soltanto i ricchi signori, adesso anche la mia piccola segretaria fa la settimana alle Maldive, quindi il mondo è cambiato moltissimo e questo bisogna tenerne conto.
And the world is full of potential customers. Being a very rich designer means shifting millions of units in a mass market. For Armani, the name of the game is diffusion. Add a cheaper line to your mainstream collection, same classy name, much bigger market. Armani, the master of diffusion, took the black label from the £1,000 garment, now with all its aspirational associations, and in a typically minimalist stroke, changed it subtly and attached it to a £500 jacket. So now more people could buy into the essential Armani lifestyle at half the price. Still too much? For a tenth of the price, you can still have the privilege of bearing that priceless Armani label on your clothes. Insight number three, conquer the world. Having diffused the look across social and economic barriers, break the geographical barrier, make the Armani label an international language of designer understatement, understood by the upwardly mobile shopping in one of hundreds of coolly lit, architecturally disciplined boutiques from Milan to Tokyo, from London to Honolulu. Of course, the worldwide clientele still has to be pretty solvent to sport the Armani emblem, even on the cheapest Armani jacket. Unless some manufacturer of mass market goods is willing to pay a fee to stamp Armani's name on their quite ordinary products, thus transforming them into talismans of good taste. It's a process called licensing, and when it works, it's a license to print money.
Polo by Ralph Lauren.
Fashion for men, Calvin Klein.
From Nina Ricci.
Donna Karen, New York. I think it's the perfect marriage.
Yves Saint Laurent.
The designers invest in nothing. This is the big benefit for them. They don't have to buy factories, they don't have to buy production plant, they don't have to bear the brunt of advertising costs. And of course, they get the benefit of any advertising that's done with using their name because they get the rub off for their own collections. So for them, it's an entree to big markets, mass consumer markets, that would otherwise require serious money to buy your way into. And for the manufacturer, they get the kudos of the designer's name and all the momentum and all the publicity that it's attracted. So in a way, they're defraying their marketing costs. It's a very cheap, easy route for them into what can be a very profitable market.
Take the sunglasses market. It's worth a shade over $1 billion annually. Everyone wants a look in.
When Bausch & Lomb called to for us to do eyewear, and they said, you know, of course I do eyewear. I've had eyewear in my ads for the past 4 years since we've started. Rosemary's always been behind a pair of glasses.
Dark glasses are like being behind a waterfall, daring and safe at the same time.
And for Donna Karan, a safe bet at no financial risk, licensing her name at a royalty of around 7% on shades at $200 per unit. Donna Karan is no sunglasses specialist. Her success has come by designing clothes for the new affluent executive woman, like herself, clothes to suit her frenetic, stressed-out urban existence.
God, New York thrills me, charges me.
Through her advertising alter ego, Rosemary McGrotha, she communicates directly with a clearly identified target market.
Are successful women different from other women?
Well, Donna Karan ought to know. Turnover has reached 240 million in a brief 6 years, and her name has soared into the designer big league.
Donna Karan.
Oh, I was opening up people's mail.
when I used to walk around this entire company opening up everything, because I said, how nice, look at all this mail I'm getting, because my name was on everything. Because I didn't realize that this became a company. So it was very, very strange. Everything that bared my name, I would go to.
And plenty of things now do bear her name. Donna Karan is a native New Yorker, in New York, of New York. With her diffusion line DKNY, she even commented her own city into her logo and licensed that.
DKNY clothing, DKNY jeans, DKNY accessories, bags, belts, shoes. Oh, yes, thank you. I needed glasses. So we did eyewear. I hope everybody really enjoys, you know, wearing them as much as I've enjoyed designing them and wearing them.
And marketing them. What she really enjoys is the business.
I get these ideas constantly. So all I love to do is I have these great ideas about new businesses. And DKNY opened up, I mean, seriously, behind the table. Menswear out of the woodwork. One day I came in, I called my partners, I said, how do you feel about doing menswear? I have a little collection here.
Honey, I really want to thank you for these. These are beautiful. Can you make me look bigger? Can you make me look bigger? I don't mean taller, I mean bigger as a man.
Barney's of New York, grand opening of Donna Karan's new menswear collection. The whole street is her showroom.
Oh, did I tell you about that suit I got, that George Bush suit? I'm going to go over it again. Yeah, it only has a right arm. Yeah, the right arm's longer than the left. It's really...
In a country born to shop, Donna Karan was born to sell.
You're 42? 42, right. That's it. I didn't do anything.
It looks fabulous.
Collection's fabulous. Fabulous.
With unabashed American zeal, the head of the company in hands-on, heartfelt, hard sell.
17 for the wool crate. 1700 for the wool crate, for the suit.
Forget the price tag. Donna believes in the product.
I mean, these are really special clothes.
This is all hand-tailored.
And they're all hand-tailored.
Who could outperform the company's greatest asset, the natural behind the name?
The whole point of menswear is the shoulder. And I think the shoulder is an amazing, amazing shoulder, how clean it is up here.
Donna Karan uses Mother Hubbard market research. If her own cupboard is bare, she'll design what's missing.
Everyone raves about flexibility.
And then sell it to you.
This is double face crepe, which I am mad for, because it feels like knit. You know, it's nothing. This is stretch mat jersey, which is, that's never been done. Wearing the new body toners that are to straighten out every bubble we had in our bodies. There's nothing that I wouldn't do. Furniture, homes, design. What I really want, I mean, everybody knows, I'm dying to do a show, a Broadway show, a book.
Three blocks from Broadway, Donna Karan, the current queen of New York fashion, reigns over a fashion business which is fickle. Looking down onto scruffy 7th Avenue, center of the U.S. rag trade, her offices on the 16th floor were previously occupied by Halston, who went bust before he died, and are downstairs from Carolyn Rome, another recent casualty of a tough, unforgiving commercialism. New York sees the extremes of entrepreneurial enterprise jammed into a few city blocks. From 7th Avenue, where immigrants labor on minimum wage in sweatshops, to 5th Avenue, where wealthy shoppers spend maximum prices on designer sweatshirts. Whatever its design, artistic, or cultural pretensions, the fashion industry's amalgam of cheap labor and artisanal skills, serving planned obsolescence, makes it a paradigm of the workings of capitalism.
Because the European couture tradition grew out of an artisanal tradition, whereas the American design tradition, which is much younger, grew out of 7th Avenue in the garment business. And, you know, these people are coming out of business, and they come out of that tradition. And the backers and the whole atmosphere surrounding them is one that says that money is king, which is why so often American clothes are money clothes. American clothes, the greatest compliment that a retailer can give to a collection is to say that it's money in the bank.
Money is in the bank at DKNY. Turnover has increased 20-fold in 6 years. Peddling an image of success has brought success. In the Donna Karan universe, it seems nothing's impossible. The marketing machinery in the UK isn't quite so well oiled. At a sock shop media event for a new range of tights, the world-famous British designer is late for the launch. The promotional event starts without her. Is this any way to promote a name?
Oh dear. Vivian Westwood.
So far, no designer has been awarded Designer of the Year twice in a row, but Vivian Westwood, Professor of Fashion at the Vienna Academy of Applied Arts, is celebrated here tonight for her awesome contributions to the British and international fashion arena. Long may they last.
I mean, we've got such a property now, as far as Vivian is concerned, especially with getting the award.
Vivian Westwood made her name, but not her fortune, as the visionary of alternative styles, widely imitated. Now her marketing team is determined to capitalise on her name.
You have to really look at what the value of that award really is. I mean, you know, at the end of the day, they don't give you 100 grand every time you get the award. You know, you get a piece of metal and it goes in your shop window or whatever, and that's it. What you actually, the kudos or whatever, or if you like, the stamp of approval that brings with it in terms of your key to enter the doors of industry and finance. I mean, in terms of, is the bank manager more liable to hand out larger overdrafts because we got the award? Probably not in the end, not in this kind of climate. And is the industry in terms of manufacturing more likely to want to take you on? Probably not. They still think that it's all quite cottage potato printing stuff.
Still no sign of the designer. The Soho Street promotions become a bit of a street obstruction.
So someone's going to move it, please.
Yes, we will move it, yes.
Yeah. Right, come on then, there's four able-bodied people here. Move it, please. Can you all stand against one side so people can use the pavement, please, madam? Thank you very much.
Meanwhile, 7th Avenue is still alive to the sounds of selling.
Zealand's wearing one.
I didn't really change.
This is his.
If you want to do filming in the street, there's a police. If you go to the police station and ask the Sergeant Wall, he'll arrange it for you.
Models and photographers' patience perhaps wearing a bit thin. Is the designer shy, diffident, or has she other things on her mind?
We all know that it's like the age of packaging and the manipulation of money. I don't subscribe to that. I believe in quality rather than quantity, and therefore it's the quality of the experience that's important. Now then, having said that, I am a fashion designer, and I couldn't do what I do with regard to fashion if I didn't have some intellectual framework that's interesting me, some topic or other. I intellectualise a little bit by saying that, you know, that there are these polarities between masculine and feminine, that it's also about being dressed and being undressed, you know, being like a nun on the one hand, or being left naked with preferably just a pair of high-heel shoes or something like that.
Definitely
got
the suspenders off the jeans.
Oh, off for him, yes. Yeah, I think it'll look much better because the two girls can do the bit and he goes with them down. Yeah. That's what I just rehearsed him with. Yeah.
Essentially, at the end of the day, it's how you do something, because an idea is the form. It's how you carry it out. And I have a great perversity and a great attraction for the unorthodox.
People have got to look at her because she is really the only thing that, if you like, the British fashion industry has to offer on that international level. People know that now, they realise that. It's in the press every day, people are talking about it, it's on everybody's lips.
I felt so frustrated. I was so angry with Vivian Westwood at the British Fashion Awards in October 1991. On the Sunday before the awards, I had seen her collection, which was one of those ones that gave me goosebumps. That's what all fashion editors long for. And it was an extraordinary collection, mixing in historical things, very English, quintessentially English in a kind of historical mix, but also very couture, very elegant. And at the actual awards, in front of a television audience that went out in front of 10 million people, she sent out just the kind of things that give Vivian the worst possible name. You know, it was ridiculous. She had the most nonsenses things with, I want to forget it. It was sort of teddy bears classed here and there. The sort of thing that makes everybody groan. I felt like picking up a plate of custard and throwing it at Vivian's face and saying, listen, if you want to be taken seriously, you can't do this. But then I stopped and I thought, the whole point about Vivian is that she's got a subversive streak in her character. That's partly what it's all about.
And I would like to quote some words from a song of Elvis Presley, which is, don't you ever kiss me once, kiss me twice, treat me nice. Thank you.
Soho Square, the photo opportunity fizzles out.
He done on you. You're doing a film on you.
So it's back to base with the designer tights to see if the designer herself has turned up. It's worth persevering. The money-making potential of licensing is the golden bauble for every designer. But for the marketing team, it's a balancing act between exposure, building the name, and overexposure, cheapening it.
Cindy was an interesting area we got involved in, the life-size doll, because of, what was she, 30 years old this year?
10 years ago, Vivian Westwood, OBE, designed a punk outfit for a Cindy doll. Tonight, she designed a pink anniversary outfit for Cindy's corporate night out. Why do it?
No, but Cindy is a fashionable little doll. She's got a bicycle like I have, I don't know.
The subversive visionary meets big business. For designer of the year and giant toy manufacturer Hambro, there's a joint objective, market share. Whether it's dolls or dresses, the fundamental marketing equation is the same, brand awareness. Bags, baubles, scarves or belts create a demand and supply it with an endless stream of products.
That's the picture from Vogue, isn't it?
Come on, but that's excellent, isn't it?
But it's really great because they've got the whole look there. They've got the bag accessory from the license in Italy. They've got the jewellery. They've got the corset. They've got the whole thing.
But there's one thing they haven't got yet, and it's the holy grail of product licensing, perfume.
Well, I've obviously started to smell a few things. They're like, I don't know, a vulture or whatever. I mean, like somebody like me is the thing that they fasten onto, because what they want to do is sit and talk to me, give me all these things to smell, get my reactions, and what they hope to do is to build up my portrait in terms of smell.
A portrait in smell? You wear it, it comes in liquid form from the chemist shop. Worldwide, the perfume market is worth an irresistible $7.5 billion. Are these designers with perfume lines on the side, or in fact, perfumiers masquerading as designers? The exclusive couture collections of some top fashion houses, Dior, Chanel, Yves Saint Laurent, lose money every season, where each outfit costing £30,000 may only be bought by 6 women around the world. It's virtually impossible to turn a profit. So why do they keep doing it? Every season, the fashion media descends on Paris to cover the couture collections, which, through their often breathtaking gaudiness, generate pages and pages of free publicity, keeping the big names constantly in the public eye. They're at the glamorous top end of a marketing pyramid. Couture is the lost leader, perfume is pure profit. When the House of Chanel was in trouble, wild man Karl Lagerfeld was brought in to up the profile. The clothes may be unwearable, but perfume sales have gone up. Over 70 years ago, Coco Chanel had the marketing insight of the 20th century. Her name was portable. It could sell anything. The first designer perfume was born. History doesn't relate what numbers 1 through 4 smelt like, but number 5 became the most successful perfume in history. What Coco Chanel realized was that perfume is a cheap entry into the designer lifestyle. An affordable luxury. Only a handful can buy $1,000 frocks, but it seems millions will spend $62 on a 7 ml bottle of liquid, the same price per ounce as 22 karat gold. Especially if it makes them feel like $1 million.
share the fantasy.
Chanel No. 5 has made hundreds of millions of dollars profit. The breakdown is simple. Ingredients, $3. Packaging, $6. Advertising, $8. Administration, $8. Profit for Chanel, $7.75. Total trade price, $33. Then a 60% retail markup plus tax brings it to $62. Dozens of names followed in Chanel's wake.
Calvin Klein.
From Nina Ricci.
Yves Saint Laurent.
Julio Iglesias? Just about everyone with a name, designer or not, it seems, got in on the act in the 80s and had a nose paint their portrait in scent. Where are they now, these unforgettable fragrances? Perfume is an impulse purchase, an alchemy of mood and marketing. A clear identity is of the essence.
Somehow, because I'm used to half of it being somebody else's and being already very famous on its own, always been in the news. And then the Paloma, even though it's very mine, if you say, you know, Paloma Picasso very fast, to most people it will sound like Pablo Picasso. How do you do it to actually say, you know, to show people in a very, you know, arresting way that it's not Pablo Picasso? Yeah. So we thought my face. And I'd been wearing red lipstick since the early 70s when it was out of fashion. And suddenly it became the most important message in the photograph. In the beginning, when I was face to face in the streets, you know, with my own face, I would get all red in the face. I would kind of blush at the sight of it, and then slowly I got used to it. I know it's very dangerous to become, you know, to get separated from yourself. I mean, the truth is, in that world, you know, there's a lot of marketing, and there's not so much real substance very often. One can't take over the other one. And I don't want the product to become more important than me.
There are up to 120 new perfume launches per year, and a proportionate number of failures. After 3 years, only one in five new perfumes is still on the shelves.
I think it's all marketing.
And there lies the perfume conundrum. Reducing the risk of failure involves risking even more money. Thus, the small players get priced out. Chanel, the brand leader, must spend millions on ads like this to maintain its share of the market. At the recent launch of Dune at the Chateau de Vaux-le-Vicomte outside Paris, Dior flew in 1,100 aristocrats, wearing Dior, of course, and celebrities in Dior, from all over the world. Cost $1 million. With so much at stake, fragrance has fallen into the hands of multinational conglomerates, who alone can afford the astronomical launch costs. Christian Dior is owned by the luxury goods conglomerate Louis Vuitton Moët Hennessy, which specializes in upmarket brand names and is itself an amalgam of famous names. The perfume formula is simple: fame first, then fragrance. Head of LVMH, Bernard Arnault, called a brilliant financial manipulator by Business Magazine, decided to apply the formula to a young French designer, Christian Lacroix, agreeing to finance the first new Paris couture house for 25 years. Designer Lacroix, backer Arnault, and marketing partner Jean-Jacques Picard devised a five-point plan.
First step was exist, which is really, it was the most difficult, is exist.
Bernard Arnault sank $12 million into a 12,000 square foot complex of showrooms, studios, offices, and a shop on the chicest street in Paris, Faubourg Saint-Honoré, staffed by a team of 80 top seamstresses and vendeurs.
Second step was be famous.
In his first couture season, Christian Lacroix will present a collection of outrageous, almost scandalous clothes. Image-hungry fashion editors will promote him avidly. He will become notorious.
I have no budget for advertising. Almost the only budget we have is couture. And all the TV, like you, coming to talk about and report about Lacroix. It's a lot, it's a fabulous amount of free advertising. Now Christian Lacroix, almost everywhere in the world, is very recognized, people know him, and say, look at, it's Christian Lacroix.
Follow couture with a quick ready-to-wear collection, then time to launch the perfume. total launch cost was rumoured to be in excess of $40 million. It was expected that people would buy C'est la vie in their millions. Anticipated profits would more than cover the $4 million annual loss-making haute couture setup. Thus, Lacroix's exotic Paris catwalk creations would bear fruit in the chemist shops of the world.
Christian Lacroix, the allure of...
There was only one flaw. They didn't. People didn't flock in their millions.
The perfume of Christian Lacroix.
No, we feel it was a little not too early to create it, but too early to introduce it everywhere in the world on the same year. Mm-hmm. That was, we had the feeling at the beginning, but as we are not technicians of parfum, we were very confident with them, but maybe it was a mistake. But it's not our job. My job is promoting and Lacroix's job is designing. Managing is Mr. Arnault's job.
Art enthralled to commerce? Designers sell their souls, or at any rate sole control of their names, to financial conglomerates, becoming brand names to penetrate mass markets. For Unilever, Daz may wash whiter, but Calvin Klein's perfumes smell sweeter. In his name, they scented money. His is the extraordinary designer perfume marketing success story of recent times, and it started with an incident in the 60s.
Escape, Calvin Klein.
I was working in this building, and it was 23 years ago, and I was working at my father's supermarket in New York City, ringing up the cash register, and I opened it up, and it was Family Circle magazine. It was a camel hair coat with a half belt in the back, and it said designed by Calvin Klein, and I thought, I quit. I'm no longer working in the supermarket. It's time to really devote all of my time to clothes.
In an age of the fashion designer as star, writer Georgina Howell observed the supreme marketing skills of a designer who became a household name.
Calvin Klein was a master of image creation. He discovered that you have to have something to market besides the garment. And that thing that he had to market was himself. And at that time, Calvin Klein was a sort of creature of the night, living a rather notorious nightlife.
But Calvin Klein soon realized the value of notoriety. Fast-living jet-setter, friend to the famous, and a fixture of the Studio 54 club scene, he saw that if tabloid journals and magazines could make money selling his lifestyle, so could he. And so began a series of high-profile links between his own sexy image, the mood of the times, and the right product.
There was a craziness and a compulsive thing that was going on at that time. It was compulsive or obsessive about work, about relationships, making a name, getting ahead, and I translated it into its obsession with love. I mean, and it almost to the point of a kind of insanity. I use that word, but I don't mean certifiable. You know, clinical insane. I just mean a kind of, you know, a frenzy going on about it.
And to fit the frenzied mood, a voluptuous sensual product, best-selling perfume number one, Obsession.
I go by my gut. Something happens in my body. I feel it, I get an emotional reaction. And as soon as I get that reaction, I know it's right. The fragrance was very strong and very powerful. And it's the kind of, I thought, it was. I wanted people to love it or hate it.
As many as 200 ingredients go into a single scent. Klein smelled endless combinations.
When I worked with the chemist, I was telling him I want scents that are very sexual, that are erotic, that are, I'm not looking for outdoorsy, sporty, green, you know, light, fresh things. I'm looking for something that smells like sex.
And looks like it, and sounds like it. Every aspect of the product must convey his message precisely.
I had writers working on names, lists and lists of names. Climax was the one. Can you imagine? They were trying to convince me to use Climax.
By the late 80s, the mood of libertarian sexuality that Klein had so skillfully marketed as obsession was changing. But it's been said of the master image maker that he can reinvent his own image to suit the times.
Society changed overnight, and it was the clean it up Reagan period. And all of a sudden, Calvin Klein got married. He cleaned up his act.
And his product line, with best-selling perfume number 2. Another personal milestone?
It sounds like you're getting into my life, and you know, that's what this is all going to come about. Isn't that interesting? But let me just say first that this is about my life, you know, and what was going on in the country. That fragrance is definitely a reflection of that. There was the AIDS scare. Everyone was scared to death about having sex with anyone else and what the consequences would be. And suddenly, relationships, people started getting back into traditional values.
He leads a perfect life. You know, his house is perfect, his wife is perfect, his appearance is perfect. Everything is 100% perfect.
The progeny of Calvin and Kelly's perfect union, the new fragrance for Unilever, needed a suitably demure name to distinguish it from the hedonism of obsession. Again, Klein's own life provided a fortuitous key.
I happen to have been going through the catalog for the Duchess of Windsor's sale of the jewelry at that time, and I'd get all of the catalogs from Sotheby's and Christie's. And I ran up to Barry's office. Barry is my closest friend and business partner, Barry Schwartz, and ran up there and, Barry, what do you think? What do you think about this ring? I want to get Kelly a ring, and I think this is so beautiful, this ring, the diamonds and the band, the gold band. And he said, Calvin, he said, look at the name of the ring. He said, it's called an eternity ring. He said, isn't that, I said, that's it. That's what I'm talking about. You know, that's what this perfume is all about. And, you know, I had to get the ring because it fit in so perfectly.
Calvin Klein and Unilever christened their new baby Eternity. They had the concept, the name, the fragrance. Now they needed a suitable vessel.
When I launched Eternity, this was so great because I remember falling in love with this bottle.
Based on an antique he and Kelly had found, the bottle's clean lines were designed to say purity from base to stopper.
It symbolized, it's the cross. I mean, it symbolized union. It symbolized relationship. It symbolized a kind of spiritual quality that I was looking for. It said through the cross, it said marriage, commitment, it said all of those things.
But did it say sacrilege?
Everyone told me, don't talk about that. They thought it might be considered controversial. They thought it might be that I was trying to take advantage of, sell something through religion or, you know, some kind of crazy thing. I saw it differently.
Calvin's faith was rewarded with Eternity sales of millions of dollars, far outstripping his clothing turnover, but with the wholesome image still perfectly aligned to the easy-wearing, elegant Calvin Klein look.
I had this image of all of these beautiful blondes and sort of in their 20s or in their 30s with children and wearing this fragrance. And I promise you that they were all standing online. For me to sign autographs, and I thought this is exactly who I was trying to reach.
And reach them he did, but nothing lasts forever, not even eternity. Times change, and a cutthroat $8 billion market is hungry for new product. Could Unilever and Calvin Klein come up with a hat trick for the nervous 90s? The new mood is sensual, but with a sporty twist, and vigorously marketed with a $10 million promotions campaign, including 41 million scent strips in glossy magazines, lavish TV commercials, and those all-important in-store launches.
Escape, Calvin Klein.
Yeah, he has great ads and great design in the bottle, and people like it, especially the ads. They're all standing, looking at the camera, and they're like, wow, this ad is so exciting. Yeah, I'll buy some.
And most exciting of all, the key to every successful launch, the glamorous presence of the legend himself.
And I hope I get a chance to meet all of you. And I'm really happy to escape to Macy's.
Thank you.
Sometimes you just get tired. You get tired of smiling and you get tired of signing. I mean, you do get writer's cramp and sometimes I can't, or I don't understand the names and you know, it's all of that silly stuff. I mean, people to stand online to see me is really, it's fantastic.
And effective, well before writer's cramp set in, $10,000 worth of fragrance had escaped from the public's pockets into Macy's, Unilever's and Calvin Klein's coffers. If Calvin Klein is calculatedly or inadvertently tracing changes in social attitudes through his personal perfume marketing stories, first obsession, then eternity, now escape, what is it that he or we are escaping from?
Escape. Calvin Klein.
One thing no designer, manufacturer, or retailer can ever escape is economic reality. Even golden boy Calvin Klein's clothing operation barely escaped bankruptcy recently, in the longest recession since World War II.
This is a funny recession. Many white-collar people have been affected. This isn't a blue-collar recession. This is a recession which says 44 lawyers at Skadden Arps are laid off today. X number of stockbrokers are laid off. People who can afford to spend $125 for Paul Stewart cotton shirt. These are the people who are being laid off.
Hi, everybody.
Gather around me, everybody. I feel a sermon coming on.
Thank you. Hi. I very rarely do this, but since I did it once already, I guess I have to do it three times, so I'm going to talk for a second.
Donna Karan gives a pep talk.
What I have to say is sometimes that the clothes don't communicate everything that you want to say, and a designer is sometimes putting out a message.
Donna's message to the assembled buyers and press is eliminate the negative, let's fight the recession by shopping, accentuate the positive, let's buy the industry out of the business blues.
You got to act, scent. The positive
pinstriped power clothes for positive thinkers. In the Donna Karan way, you dress for success.
The one thing fashion designers don't want you to ever think is that they're having a hard time because they're representational of success and of achievement and wealth. That's why you want to see their name on your dress or your shirt or your, because you want to sympathize, you want to empathize, and you want their status. So certainly, none of us want to empathize with somebody who's about to file for Chapter 11, do we? I think that designers who pride themselves on knowing the tenor of the times sense that we're moving into a conservative mode, and so the clothing which they're designing is conservative.
It would be very neat and easy to pretend that the mood had changed right at the end of the 80s as though the decade was a discrete entity, and of course it wasn't. A lot of the mood of the 80s, the whole designer decade, sort of flaky, frivolous, conspicuous consumption, was really a hangover from the 70s. People were getting pretty bored with it. By 1988, the economy was starting to slow down, environmental issues were becoming of greater and greater concern, and so there was that big backlash against the sort of glitzy, glowing, glossy, very febrile values of the 80s, and that was exacerbated in 1990 by the Gulf War, the fact that the recession was getting deeper, not just in Britain, but also in the States. And so we saw this whole swing again, the sort of very superficial, showy spirit of the 80s.
Fashion got so big and so profitable that companies could afford to back crazy, idiosyncratic designers. And now that the 80s are over, companies are not willing to back these kinds of people. People with huge businesses and lots of products, like Calvin, who has a perfume and has accessories and has all kinds of licensees, they're going to survive it. It's the poor kid, usually, who makes clothes. And, you know, it's very hand-to-mouth existence. Those are the people that are going to go under, and those are the people that are suffering. And that's too bad, because those are the people that keep fashion moving.
And when fashion grinds to a halt, enter The Gap, Muji, no-name studios in Italy, utilitarian, egalitarian styles, profiting from the new consumer abroad who no longer wants to pay that extra 1,000% for the designer's name on the label, for whom ostentation is out of fashion. The Gap's white, cotton, single-pocket T-shirt is reputedly the most successful garment since World War II. And quick on the uptake at going down market is Giorgio Armani himself, the original designer for the upwardly mobile. With Armani jeans and AX stores, he is reaching closer and closer to the mass market of ordinary people, as, ironically, he himself, dressed characteristically in T-shirt and jeans, becomes richer and richer and more removed from daily life.
Tante cose ho perso l'abitudine di tante cose, perché la mia vita è molto, molto inquadrata. Non so montare su un autobus, non so come si va in metropolitana a Milano, non lo so. Io entrerei dall'uscita, uscirei dall'entrata. Cioè non mi so muovere bene nel mondo attuale, perché non lo vivo. No, non so muovere i soldi, io sono molto ridicolo.
I'm not particularly good with money, I mean, I lose it all the time. I mean, I can't keep it. If I need a taxi or something, I find I don't have any.
Terrible. Not bad, terrible. I do not deal with any of that.
I miei collaboratori, quando mi vedono toccare i soldi, mi dicono, ma tu non sai toccare i soldi, non hai la percezione dei soldi.
Meanwhile, money changes hands in the street markets of Bangkok, New York, London and Paris as a vast parallel industry, the trade in counterfeit names, continues unabated. Like vultures, picking over the carcass of the designer decade, tearing off shreds of the fame and glamour acquired by a handful of names who at their height had a whole culture in thrall.